the hungry people. They don't know that they're going to get food on this ship for 7 days. Hey, how you guys doing over there? I think this is the Marriott Hotel in Florida. Breakfast time. It's break fast. And this is Ken getting more food. I got you, Ken. How you doing?
Great.
I got it.
Well, we are sitting here in the lobby waiting for the buses to pick us up to take us to the ship. Hello? This is Joanne Huffman taking a snooze. And she could care less about us.
Hey,
yeah?
You get a snore?
No, she's not snoring.
Yeah, you.
I was?
Yes, you were snoring.
I told that woman next to me, I said, now if I snore, you wake me up.
Supposedly you injured. Both were, you were.
Maybe it's in his brain.
Oh, that's not bad at all.
Could you hear Joanne snoring? Bjorn?
I don't want to be there.
She was snoring.
Uh-oh, it's not running. What a big luck. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, just to let you know, this is our first day. We just arrived in Nassau. And here's everybody. Here's Floyd. Having a good time, eating breakfast. It's about 7 o'clock in the morning. There's what's his name?
Hi.
Yeah, he's having a good time. Look at his plate. There's some friends of ours in the background.
Dick said it sounds like Bjorn keeps you in the dark.
No, I released it.
Robin Pope, it runs when you release. You have to push it again to stop it.
Okay, here we are in Nassau. I just want to let you see this ship. It is huge. Oops, can't see it. Wait, hold on. See, that's the front. That's the gang. Am I going too fast? Oh gosh, look at this. There's everybody embarking. We're waiting here to go on a tour. Look at the size of that boat. There's Bjorn. Ha 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 ha. Still decorating. There's Ken. Joanne. Funny time. That's our guide. That lady right there. I mean, just look at the enormous size of this ship. Bjorn, the guide, is telling them what she's going to do. It's pretty nice out today. It's in the high, it's in the 70s, but you need a sweater. This is what happens when you have money. Uh-oh, there goes Ken. There's Joanne, there's Joanne. So Lisa. Where's Ken? There he is. We have been waiting for this guy for I don't know how long. Thought we lost him. There he is right now.
Yeah. I screwed it up. I screwed it up again with the camera.
The camera running and she's
taking pictures
and she's talking all kinds of stupid thing in this recording.
All our conversation. Well, your light's on now.
Well, she's
short-legged ones up here, most qualified. Right up here. Ladies, take your time. Sir, come on.
Yeah, I see it over there.
Oh, yeah?
This is the top seat. And climbing on the walls.
Yeah, about fell on her fanny.
Hi, Dulcie.
I bet.
What do you call that? Geiger counter? No.
What do you call that?
Geiger counter.
Is it a Geiger counter? High metal?
I'd rather live in Phoenix than I would here.
Yeah.
Oh, Phoenix is so drop.
I'll see with this sitting this
is, no, this is just our cruise ship sitting there in the harbor of Nassau, Bahamas.
Yeah.
And Tulsi don't want to live here. It looks too dumpy.
Oh.
This is the harbor area.
They have to say that the policemen look very nicely dressed. I mean, look how neat.
What a tower.
Oh, please.
It's 170 miles long. Yes, Darcy.
Get out of here.
We really had fun with that lady that took us around in a limo.
We're gonna come back and visit her.
Fire drill? No, the testing the two of the game horses.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is what we do when it's waiting for lunch. Play cards. Real serious stuff over on this side. I like the back table over there. Here we are again in the card room. Beautiful day today. Just beautiful.
Got one?
Two. Some really serious plans going on. Still quiet, we're just waiting for the poker. Lunch. Carol, she's going to go gamble in the casino. Bye, Carol. Bye.
This is the sun deck, and we'll see how everybody behaves up here. Hello. The water in the pool splashing. We're rolling a little bit. Okay, here we are.
this is our cabin. Kind of messy, don't worry about it. And then... And now we even have a port. I want the sun to get in. Look, they've had a bathroom.
Go ahead.
I'm going to run it through again.
Okay, now what were you saying before I
you interrupted.
Yeah,
I wrote a little thing about Mary had a little lamb.
Yeah.
And it was like a sheep. It came here on this cruise and died from lack of sleep. Now you do one. Roses are red. Be creative.
You know one good thing? There won't be any dummies in heaven.
Oh, we're gonna miss you.
The rafters free. It was there I learned to pray. When I was just a kid. Now I'm far away. I'm so glad I did. Someday I'm going.
Journey of my life were a country road. Important landmarks along that road would be places of worship. The little white church with the pot-bellied stove in the center of the pews where I first heard about a land called Beulah. The village church where as a kid I listened to the old saints testify to the faithfulness of God through the years. The church by the river where I had my first date and the youth group would sing Kumbaya around the campfire on the riverbank after Sunday night services. Along my journey is the church where I promised my sweetheart I'd be faithful till death do us part. And the place where we brought our first baby to be dedicated to God. And at one church by the road I said goodbye to my precious father and later my mother. And because of those who came to share our grief, I knew we would not walk on alone. So when the church bell rings this Sunday morning, I'll hear a whole chorus of bells in my heart. And I'll go into the house of the Lord full of gratitude for those wonderful places that brought me to Sunday meeting.
It was there I learned to cry to worship you.
Some of you have the Christmas video, and there's a sweet lady that gave a testimony on the Christmas video about her experience, which is rather unique. Lee and Hal Ezell are dear friends. Gloria and me, Hal, her husband is here tonight. I'm here all week on the ship. And Lee, you're with friends, and share your story with us. God bless you.
My husband and I were talking the other day about these beautiful songs of the church. And for him, they have such nostalgic, beautiful memories being raised in the church. I was not raised in the church, so for me, they have no nostalgic value. But I'm so glad that because of what the Gaithers are doing, I think generations to come will be able to enjoy the beautiful anointing and the truth of these beautiful old songs. Not being raised in the church, I had no musical background. I had no relationship with God. Born and raised in the inner city of Philadelphia, both of my parents were alcoholics. And I was told by my father that I was one of his unwanted kids. He had enough already. So growing up without any religious contact, the first religious song I would hear would be, "Just As I Am." sung by the Billy Graham Crusade as I wound up there by mistake one night, and for the first night really heard the truth about God, and realized for the first time that Jesus Christ had been on the outside of my life all this time, waiting for an invitation to come in. And receiving him in that night was such a simple prayer of faith. I never could have imagined what that would mean for the rest of my life. And shortly after that, I would find myself as a virgin teenager, raped and pregnant from that experience, and a very confused teenager who didn't understand why God would let bad things happen to good people. And I'm sure you folks already realize that bad things happen to good people. I finally realize that now. I'm 53. I would be 54, but I was sick a year. I'm finally old enough to realize that. And as a result of that experience of being pregnant, I did not know what I would do. A friend talked to me about having an abortion, and I'm grateful that I had the time to search the scriptures and find out so clearly God talks about the sanctity of human life. And for me, according to what I read in the Bible, I made the decision that abortion is too permanent an answer for a temporary problem, and I would find myself going full term with the pregnancy and would give up the baby for adoption at birth. And records are sealed in California, where I was living then, and I knew that was a closed chapter of my life. I never got to see the child or hold the child. I just knew that some adoptive person out there was now raising my child. If you're an adoptive parent, I'm so glad there are so many of you wonderful people who have proven that having an unplanned pregnancy doesn't mean you have an unwanted child. And I would meet many people after that who had unexplainable things happen in their lives that didn't make any sense. Afterwards, I would meet my husband, who is here with me. We're celebrating our anniversary, or as my husband calls it, our anniversary. And oh, how strange it would be that my husband would, his first wife would die with a brain tumor, and his second wife would die with another form of cancer. He had some unanswered questions in his life also. Of course, when he asked me to be number three in that long line of losers, you'll find that I take vitamins and I'll be in the fitness center up on the top there, because I hope that I last a long time. For me, I would find over those years that God was able to give us answers to things there seemed to be no answers for in the natural. And I was finding out about the faithfulness of God. Just about the time I picked up the telephone at home, and the voice on the end of the phone would say, "Hello, you've never met me, but you're my mother." And whoa, here was this, what I referred to as the missing piece of my life, on the end of the telephone, calling me from Michigan, saying she had two reasons for trying to seek me out and find me. One was, she said she thought I'd like to know I was a grandmother. I had two children out there in Michigan. And the second reason for her trying to find me was even sweeter to me than the first. And that was, in that first telephone conversation, that child tried to do what she always dreamed someday she could do, and that was, she tried to lead me to Jesus on the telephone. And she was quoting me from the Bible, and I was just frozen to my seat, and I let her go for a while to see if she was any good. And she really did seem to know what she was doing. How great it was to tell her, "Your name is Julie. Well, I think you're trying to lead me to Jesus, but you already did that many years ago." And after the writing of our book and so many experiences in our one